This past weekend, I just relaxed and went to the beach, or the beach for those of you who don't speak overly exaggerated French accent. And I really need to do this more because the beach is like pretty much just right the frick there, and it's one of my favorite places.
We're on the beach! Yay! It's so pretty!
And while I was there, even though I was in total chill out mode, and for once I wasn't stressing about all the stuff I always feel like I have to be doing, I came across something so weird and so wonderful and so crazy that I just had to make a video about it. It's these little guys. Like this one here. So these animals that I'm showing you on the beach here are missing their heads, and yet when you touch them, they move. So what the heck is going on here? Life after death? Reanimation? Witchery? The real answer may actually be cooler than all of that combined. So these kind of look like little itty-bitty lobsters, but they are not. These animals are commonly known as sand crabs or mole crabs, and these ones here on Ocean Beach in San Francisco are Pacific mole crabs. And it is a crustacean like a crab or a lobster, meaning it's a decapod to be exact. It has 10 legs, and sand crabs like this burrow down into wet sand all over the world, including both American coasts. They are sometimes called sand fleas, but sand fleas are actually the much smaller cousins of these guys, and even though they're called sand fleas, they're not actually insects. They are also crustaceans, and they do jump around in a very flea-like manner and can leave some nasty bites, but they're different from these bigger ones, and they're not bugs, they're crustaceans. Anyway, Pacific mole crabs look like this when they're whole, and they're one organism that can commonly cause those little air bubbles that you see when the waves recede on the beach, because that's them breathing. They dig down into the wet soil, and when the water comes in, they stick up their little eye stalks and their feathery antenna to catch floating bits of stuff that they can eat. I actually think they're kind of cute. But lots of other things on the beach think they're mighty tasty. We saw seagulls wade out into the very shallow water left by a receding wave and dig down into the sand with their beaks to find a tasty, tasty mole crab. And then what was left on the beach as the tide rolls out is a mole crab massacre. And as I was researching just what mole crabs are and how they do this really bizarre animation after death thing, I was surprised by just how interesting these seemingly obscure and unimportant creatures actually are. Because this tidal area is so rough, they often get picked up and tossed around when the waves go in and out, and then they have to really rapidly dig back down into the sand to bury themselves again. And they actually dig so fast that we can't even see how they do it. So scientists had to capture it in slow motion video to understand it. They go down backwards, butt first, burrowing with their behinds and whipping the sand so fast with their tails that they essentially make the sand act like a liquid. This is a phenomenon called liquefaction. Because sand is technically a solid, but under enough stress of the right kind and intensity, like say vibration from an earthquake, it behaves like a liquid, which is why some sediments are riskier to build on than others, is because they're at risk of liquefaction during an earthquake event. So the way that mole crabs dig is super cool and something we didn't know about before these scientists decided to study it. And some scientists are actually looking at these organisms as models to maybe make more effective digging robots. So that's an amazing side tangent, but that doesn't exactly explain why they keep moving after they die. How can they keep digging and digging their butts down into the sand just like they do when they're alive, even after a seagull has gulped their heads down for lunch? The answer to this question is similar to the reason that many animals actually continue moving after decapitation. I know this is a little morbid, but it's really interesting, so stick with me here. For a lot of vertebrates, that is, animals with some kind of skeleton and spinal cord, not all bodily movements are controlled by the brain. For the most part, your body's voluntary movements are controlled by the brain. Like if you're thirsty and you want to reach for a glass of water, your arm reaches for it and then brings it up to your mouth. Your arm moving and your fingers closing around the glass and your arm bringing the glass up to your lips are all voluntary movements. The way your brain does this is really complicated. It involves many parts of the brain doing lots of complicated things in tandem and talking to each other, but in brief, it involves electrical impulses within your brain sending messages through your spine and your nerves to your motor neurons and other interneurons that control movement in your muscles. Your brain also receives feedback from your sensory receptors during this whole process and can change the signals it then sends to your muscles to adjust your reactions to stuff, and it's incredibly complicated and in-depth, so if you actually want a whole overview of that, like a step-by-step, then let me know, because I will totally make a video on that. It would probably be really long, but we don't actually have time right now. That's the very simple gist. The point is, we often think of our brain as in charge of all of this. So why do bodies sometimes still move even after the brain is detached? It's because some movement impulses are actually stored in the spinal cord instead of the brain. Some animals, like sea turtles, for example, can keep swimming for some time after losing their heads. And chickens really can keep running around without theirs, too. And this is because their spinal cords have neural nets embedded in them that are pre-programmed to send electrical impulses to the parts of the body involved in really common activities that these animals engage in all the time, like swimming or running. And so these programs can run in the background without input from the brain. It's like the brain is trying to offload some of its data so it can focus on other things. So when animals lose their heads, those neural nets can keep running, but only for a short time. Those circuits still rely on electrical impulses, and after the animal is technically dead, there's a finite store of those left. So it will keep moving without the brain, but only until the charge runs out, so to speak. Another quick side note, this can actually sometimes happen in humans too. Even after we die, our nerves may contain some lingering electrical impulses, which is why there are so many stories of people seeing bodies move after they're dead. Our nerves are just gradually discharging those leftover impulses until they're gone. Spooky. But I hear you. You may be saying, Marin, mole crabs are crustaceans. They don't have a spinal cord. They don't have a brain. So how can this be happening in them? You're 100% correct. Mammals, birds, reptiles all belong to a phylum called chordata, meaning we have an internal skeleton and some kind of dorsal nerve cord, like our spinal cord in humans. And that leaves a lot of animals out, including mollusks, insects, crustaceans, and tons more. Crustaceans don't have a nervous system like you and I do. Theirs is a little more like an insect's. Instead of a brain, they have something that's called a supraesophageal ganglion. Ooh. It's the main mass of nervous tissue on top of the animal's esophagus, and it's connected to a main ventral cord, like on the bottom of their body, which is connected to several ganglia, or nerve centers, all over the animal's body. Now, most scientists, especially due to the results of some experiments from the last few years, are pretty sure that this nervous system is capable of processing lots of things, including pain. So even though organisms like this may seem primitive to you and me, I think they're more like us than we might like to think. Which brings us back to the final answer to our question. I know I take so long to get there, but there's just so many interesting things to talk about. No, mole crabs don't have a brain or a spinal cord, but they probably also have pre-programmed electrical impulses left in their main nerve centers, just like other animals do in their spinal cords. And these nerve centers are primarily located in the abdomen and may not be removed when the mole crab's head is eaten by a predator. So they still have some electrical nerve impulses staved up in patterns of movement that are most essential and basic to them. Like digging down into the sand, their main mode of survival. So that's the long answer to that question, discovered on a beach vacation day. Has going to the beach ever ignited your curiosity about something? Because for some reason, whenever I decide to take a break, that's sometimes when I get the most inspired. Let me know how the beach has piqued your curiosity down in the comments below, and subscribe to this channel for more videos like this. I had so many other cool fun facts to tell you in this video, but I didn't want it to get too long, so please consider going over to my Patreon and supporting me over there, both for access to like behind the scenes stuff and the extra material, but also cool perks like stickers and having your name roll in the credits here. As always, thank you so much for watching. I love talking about this stuff with you, and and I will see you next time.